Thank you. Stephen, I'm passing it over to you.
Okay. Everybody, please take your seats. We have not much time, which is commensurate with the preparation that my fellow panelists and I have done for this panel. So that's lucky. I want to start just with an observation, and then I'll ask John and Liz and then Floyd to comment. But just in the last 2 days, one of the things I force myself to do all the time is to spend 10 or 15 minutes, at least 10 or 15 minutes a night, flipping from MSNBC to Fox News and back to MSNBC and Fox News, which I think is a discipline that everybody ought to force themselves to do. And particularly in the last 48 hours, or 72 hours now, you get the sense that you're literally watching two different versions of reality. It's almost as if the panelists and I had a debate about whether it's raining out right now. It's actually not raining out, and all of us could probably agree that what the weather is right now. So my question, in watching that, my reaction just to the news of the last 72 hours is the country ever going to agree again on anything significant? If people are getting two different versions of the news and paying attention to two different versions of reality, is there any hope? Is there any hope that John and Floyd will agree on tax policy, for example? Or maybe even agree on what the current tax code says, I guess. But let me ask you, John, what's the solution, if a solution is needed, to getting us to start at least to coalesce around the same reality?
I'm not sure I know. I have the foggiest idea how to answer that question. What I will say is that this is what's going on now is the end result of a process spanning decades, cultural, you might say sort of like very highbrow cultural, socio-cultural, political theory that I think began at the highest in the sort of the highest precincts of the academy, and that has drifted down over time to take over the general culture of the West, and by which I mean sort of this notion that there is no truth, there are only narratives, that the reality as we know it is, needs to be deconstructed, that we all, language means whatever language means to the person who is using it. This was a very, fancy, highfalutin, deconstructionist set of theories that largely took root in France in the 1960s, came here to the Academy in the 1970s, and we now see a kind of popular expression of it in this notion that you have your narrative, I have my narrative, you want to talk about how the Comey firing means that obviously Trump colluded with Russia and is about to be impeached, and I want to talk about how a new FBI director will reopen the investigation into Hillary's emails. So each of these represents a degradation of what was just basically high-flown bullshit from half century ago, and the consequences of it are now just total and pervasive, and the fact that the primary explicator and example of deconstructionism in action is Donald Trump is itself a very interesting cultural reality that I don't think Jacques Derrida or Paul Dumas ever imagined would be the case.
As much as President Trump was a devotee of those two.
Oh,
people.
Absolutely, yeah. Yes. I think he was thumbing through the books, thumbing through Derrida last night, in fact.
So Liz, let me ask you from your standpoint of being at the New York Times, but actually not being at the New York Times, do the people at the Times wake up every morning and hope to be presenting that down the middle version of reality, and how do you think that's working out?
I don't think that's working out as well as I might like it to. I think that the times already started, I believe, from more of a center-left position. The majority of its readers are to the left. They would identify as Democratic from the information that I've been able to obtain. And from what I can see from the letters that I get into my office, they're not all, it's not all clear where they reside, but politically, but they tend to be from the left. And I think it is, I think it's very dangerous for the reason that you just pointed out, that the New York Times not be seen, that it's not seen, I'm sorry, by the whole country as a legitimate, honest source of news. And I don't think that really is the case.
Is the Times helped? If the Times calls something President Trump does a lie versus a misstatement, doesn't that undercut that goal?
Yeah, I think so. I think that there are rare occasions where you're very blunt about things, and I am all for being blunt. I am all for hard charging investigations. It's not clear what's going to happen in terms of the investigation into any links within the Trump administration to Russia. The media ought to be all over that, because that's the one thing that we do have outside Trump's control. So I'm all for that. But when you start using language like lie, and you're comfortable saying that over again, and there are any number of words that have a cast to them, I think that starts to pull you more toward MSNBC than it does, obviously, to Fox. And I don't think that the Times ought to be looking like either one of those sides.
Floyd, what in this environment, what's the dream case and the dream client you'd like to have?
Well, first, we need President Trump to move beyond what was referred to in the Washington Post today as Twitter abuse and into some sort of actual step against the press. A lot has happened, but most of it, and it's just, remember, it's just 115 days or so, and it's not that words don't matter. They matter a lot. But what we haven't had, is any proposal for new legislation. What we haven't had is a prosecution under the Espionage Act, one of the things that I fear a great deal in terms of the dangers to the press and press freedoms. What we haven't had yet are leak investigations directed at the press. It's early. John's publication is one of these days going to publish a symposium on whether the press is threatened, whether there's a threat to free speech. And I don't think there's any doubt. Of course there's a threat. You just have to listen to the president, and there's a threat. And the fact that he makes it is important, too. At the same time, though, it was John Adams who got the Sedition Act through, and journalists were jailed. Journalists were jailed under Lincoln. It was Teddy Roosevelt who tried to get Joseph Pulitzer jailed. We're not there yet in 110 days, and we'll have to see how much of this is talk, and if and when the talk becomes action. One more example. The president has recently repeated something he said while he was running, which is that he wanted to loosen the libel laws. He doesn't know that there is no federal libel law. So there is nothing to loosen except the First Amendment, which limits state libel, all libel law, state law. So, you know, is he going to do something, try to do something about New York Times against Sullivan? There's nothing he can do. He can try to amend the Constitution or to stuff the Supreme Court with people who would change currently binding law. So it's early, but there's more than a whiff of danger in the air.
I just wanted to say that my guess is that a lot of people in this room don't know how aggressive the Obama administration was on some of these fronts, and it is important while everybody freaks out on a daily basis about the oncoming fascist takeover of the United States that Barack Obama, you know, in the Fast and Furious investigation at the Justice Department, was incredibly aggressive subpoenaing records from AP, that there was an effort potentially to charge James Rosen of Fox News with a violation of the Espionage Act for getting a leak about North Korea from an official at the State Department. I think there were 7 cases, prosecutions, something like that, under some of these terms during the Obama administration. And so if so far Trump has done nothing anywhere remotely close to such things, and I think the threat to speech and the threat to the press to talk about it as though this was something that resulted ab initio from November 8th. And largely what we're seeing is an assault on the very idea of free speech on college campuses, none of which are operating from a conservative or Trumpian perspective, I think is to distort the picture a little bit.
The most important thing I think he's done is to try to delegitimize the press, and that daily denigration of the press, and I must say of truth-telling by the press, is a fact in and of itself, and a dangerous one.
But it's a constitutionally protected activity.
Of course.
Right? Sure. Speaking of which, I noticed about an hour before we assembled here that the president this morning was tweeting that he's thinking of eliminating the daily press briefing. Does anybody on this panel think that matters?
I think it matters to Saturday Night Live a lot.
Yeah, I mean, other than being a great afternoon, you know, live TV show. If you're really bored, you can watch it at 1:30. Does it matter at all?
I think it would be a net positive toward the goal that you were speaking of. I mean, if anybody watched Sarah Huckabee Sanders yesterday, I think that was a very alarming moment in American history. I don't mean to be like having said everyone's freaking out about everything. I freaked out about that yesterday because there was a tradition forever, including, you know, when Ron Ziegler was speaking for Nixon, of people who were attempting to defend either the indefensible or the very hard to defend or something they couldn't really talk about, that the nature of which they would twist themselves into pretzels in order to conform with stated fact while spinning like crazy was the art of being a press secretary, right, or being a public spokesman, because the idea was once you cross the line into outright lies and prevarications, no one would listen to you, no one would trust that when you said so-and-so came into the Oval Office, or, you know, we had 350 people in the Roosevelt Room, that they would believe that either. Well, yesterday, and this has been going on, obviously, since Sean Spicer took the podium, but yesterday, Sarah Huckabee Sanders 7 times lied about something she had said in a previous sentence. I mean, I'm not kidding, and this is in front of the country, and this is now the job of the White House press secretary, is to go out and lie. I'm sure my guess is that, you know, this is one of the reasons that Trump approves of Spicer, and so that he is willing to say whatever it is necessary to say to get through the hour. And that in some ways, you show the greatest fealty that you can to somebody like him by being willing to do just almost anything to get through and make him look good or get through a difficult question. under those circumstances, I think it would be a benefit to the country for these press briefings to end, and I don't mean that disingenuously. I don't know, it will simply be a battle between people saying, did the president say this, and then a press secretary saying no or saying yes, and you would literally have no idea whether or not that statement was true.
But I think the opposite is true. I think everything you said for the first 80% of your presentation was accurate. And the result of that is that we need confrontations like this. We don't have a question period, as they do in Parliament in England. We don't have a mechanism for presidents to and their defenders to be put to the task of responding. The fact that there have been lies, and we both use the word meaning it, lies told, and lies told in our presence, because we see it on television live, is not an argument, in my view, against continuing with the press briefings. It's an argument to have still more vigorous press examination to expose the lies.
Yeah, I agree with Floyd.
I don't disagree with that. I just don't know.
Well, I had the exact same feeling. I thought, yeah, I'm on board with this. And then when it got to the conclusion, I'm like, I don't know. I think it's a very bad statement for the administration to even threaten to cut that off. It's really the only regular exposure that they have to the media, where they put themselves out there, occasionally put someone else out there. There is no news that comes out of those, or it's very rare that you're going to get actual information about what's going on in the administration that the media's not been able to figure out elsewhere. But for the same reasons that John and Floyd articulated, there are many, many times where all of the public, possibly on MSNBC and Fox, see that there's not continuity in the statements, that there's, you know, there's falsehoods, there's you know, wholesale reversals on what they said in a previous sentence and what they said in a later sentence. And that's important to see. Even Fox, because I look at it reasonably regularly too, it's enough theater when that happens. They may have a different explanation for it, but it's enough theater that they even run some of that material. So I do think they're important at the end of the day.
What about the notion of taking the 50 or 60 or 80 journalists who squeeze into that room and instead sending them out to each of the government agencies every day that are actually responsible for the government and asking questions of officials there, as opposed to just hanging around the White House Sarah Sanders?
I think in most large news organizations anyway, there are reporters out in those agencies. There are reporters that cover the FBI or the State Department or the Justice Department, the CIA. They're not the White House
right,
reporters.
No, I understand that, but most organizations aren't the Times.
That big?
Don't have.
Well, I mean, it must be said, while people worry about the fate of the media in the Trump era, that for those of us who work or run media organizations or anything like that, this is some kind of weird golden age. My circulation is up almost 25%. My web traffic is up 20%. This was not true during the election season. Only after the election season was over, the Times has shown startling numbers. I saw a study yesterday by some apartment rental agency that suggested, I don't know how they knew this, but whatever, that the number of journalism jobs in Washington is up 25% over the last 2 years, whereas, of course, the story nationwide is a complete cratering of the journalism workforce. I mean, it's like worse than coal and something like, it's like four, no, so, and that's not a joke.
Yeah, yeah.
It's gone
a lot of
from
things
400,
are worse than coal.
Yeah, but it's gone from like 435,000 people working in the media in various capacities to about 175,000 over the past 15 years. And Washington is seeing a reversal of this, and where you're going to see people, the question is whether they will be used properly. In other words, is it just going to be 22-year-olds writing, you know, clickbait headlines and pieces about how they feel about Sarah Sanders, or will it be, in fact, people going at all these organizations that are flush and have money and have traffic and are hiring people, are they going to do this spade work at the agencies? When I started in Washington as a journalist in 1984, everybody had people everywhere. I mean, granted, that was, again, that was a golden age just before everything cratered. But, I mean, when you ran the American Law, you probably had 10, 15 people working, right? I mean, you had justice.
30.
You had people, 30 people at agencies in Washington. That wasn't even, you know, a major American newspaper. It was a great publication, but it was a publication that depended on a core audience. Right. It wasn't a mass media publication. Mm-hmm. And now they're all gone, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, how many people were in the state, were in the State Department press room, you know, 40 years ago? There were probably 75 to 100 people every day. And now if there are 30, that's a lot.
I want to ask Floyd one more question, then we're going to take questions from the group. If the president decided today that he is going to go ahead and continue with the press briefings, but he's not going to allow people from organizations that are reporting fake news to have press credentials anymore, is there a way to challenge that?
Yeah, there really is some case law. Not at the level of the presidency, but there's some pretty good law saying that the exclusion of journalists from an otherwise public or public-like event is actionable.
But this would be the exclusion of some journalists and the inclusion of others, which probably makes the case stronger,
look, I guess. I hate to put it this way. They would lie about what they were doing, but if it could be demonstrated that what was happening was the exclusion of liberal journalists or critics of the president who don't misbehave in front of the world at these press conferences, that could give rise to a very serious legal claim, yeah.
Now that may be one we see. Let's take a couple of questions. We have to wrap up pretty quickly. Right there.
That there's been a devolving nature of issues, not only the press conferences, but also the issue this morning of threatening Comey with leaking what happened at their now infamous dinner. My question is, and out of disclosure, I chair something called the Shadow Cabinet, which is some of the 18 most prominent former individuals speaking truth to power at shadowing Trump is the Twitter handle. The question is twofold. Do you believe that Trump will complete his term to the panel? And second, if not, on what basis, whether it would be impeachment, the 25th Amendment, if people develop the armor to, including Pence, to invoke that, or by the release of his tax returns and possibly his refusal?
Okay, let's get a quick answer. Floyd?
I think he'll complete his term.
John?
I not only do I think that one should presume that he will complete his term, I think that for people who oppose Trump, the sort of the dwelling on the fantasy that somehow he will be removed, deus ex machina, is a very dangerous thing, and it will retard proper efforts to oppose him. This is no magic wand is going to be waved by the Senate and the House, which are now in Republican hands, at least to get a two-thirds majority to impeach and then another two-thirds majority to convict. This is a delusion, and it should be. Now, could he resign? Yes. Could the 25th Amendment be invoked? Yes. Could he have a heart attack? Yes. Is that something that you think is gonna happen? The odds are incredibly low. Focusing on this, I tell friends of mine who are very liberal, is harmful to your cause, not helpful.
I don't think the media's been very good at predicting much in the last 6 months about the election, so I'm keeping my chips right here.
One more question. This one over there.
Hi. So loud. I saw an article recently about newspaper in like journalism deserts. So there's like all these journalists crowded on the coasts, and there's not a lot of reporting happening in the Trump America that elected him. What is your guys' take on that? Is it going to get worse? Are you guys instating solutions to that?
Well, where it's really bad are in state capitals all around the country. I saw some number a couple of weeks ago where Tallahassee, you know, and the Florida state government has never been a model of great government. The number of reporters, you know, who cover the state government and the legislature in Florida is like a tenth of what it was 10 years ago, and you have that going on all the time, and that's because of the, you know, the economic model for local newspapers has really almost evaporated.
I mean, that was a piece by Jack Schaefer. It was a terrific piece in Politico about the news deserts. The one thing I will say is that when journalism was wildly fully staffed in 1980, 79, 80, most of the journalist establishment did not see or understand or predict the strength of the Reagan victory in 1980, despite the fact that they were everywhere and everybody was fully staffed. So the notion, which I think is the theme of the news desert, that we're not seeing things that we could otherwise see because people aren't reporting, is somewhat belied by the fact that there are so many instances in the past when that was the case, and yet all sorts of things, the rise of the religious right, the power of certain types of arguments that the media do not enjoy and don't agree with, nonetheless gaining purchase all over the country, you know, I think that's a problem inside the soul of the media rather than a personnel issue.
On that soulful note, we will end. Thank you.
Thank you very much.